All right, hello everybody. I think we'll kick off. It's just past the hour. My name is Ginny Barber. I'm the Director of Open Access Australasia. I've just put up a few here, logistics as usual for these webinars. Just if you can keep your webcams off and your micro muted, and type your questions into the chat, and we'll get the chance to ask them at the end of each video. So just a little bit about Open Access Australasia. We're an organisation that works across Australia and New Zealand. We have a fabulous executive committee, Kim Terry, who's the chair of our executive committee, I'll pass over to in a moment. And our executive committee represents the universities across Australia and New Zealand. We also have a group of organisations that we work with that are affiliates, and our aim is to support open access, particularly our diversity approaches across the region. So I'll pass over now to Kim to introduce the webinar and to kick us off.
Kia ora koutou katoa, nō mai, haere mai, and welcome to our webinar for today. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce the COPM team, who I will introduce individually in a moment, but first I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which you are today, their elders past, present and emerging, and their enduring connection to the place where you are. Please feel free to introduce yourself in the chat while we watch the videos, and acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land where you are today. As Ginny said, I'm Kim Tidy. I'm the current chair with the absolutely fabulous executive of Open Access Australasia. And it's my pleasure to welcome you all today and introduce our speakers. So the way the session will work is we've got a couple of videos, and there'll be some question and answer with our COPM colleagues who are here at an incredibly unreasonable time for them, but an absolutely fantastic time for us. So we'll be full of energy, and they will too. Tom has a kitten or a cat that may make an appearance. And as he has said in the chat, the cat's name is Mouse. So he's already got a big thumbs up from the audience today, because many of us are cat lovers. So I'll get right into introducing the speakers. So on the video today, we have Professor Martin Paul Eve, who many of you will have seen him speak in different open access forums. He's the Professor of Literature, Technology and Publishing at Birkbeck University of London, and is the COPM project co-lead and co-founder of the Open Library of Humanities. And then also, I won't get distracted again, but there's Mouse. Hello, Mouse. Dr. Joe DeVille is the senior lecturer at Lancaster University and is the COPM project co-lead and co-founder of Mattering Press. And then the question and answer panel that we have, who have their cameras on, Lucy Barnes, who's the editor and outreach coordinator at Open Book Publishers, a leading UK scholar-led non-profit and open access press, and she does outreach for COPM project. Then we've got Tom and Mouse. Tom works on the opening the future package at COPM on outreach to publishers and libraries and lots in between. Hopefully he'll get to talk about the in between today. He was previously the founding team member of the UK's first consortial open access press, White Rose University Press. And then we have Livy, who is the Library Outreach Associate for Punctum Books. She participates in Work Package 2 on the Open Book Collective as part of the COPM project, and conducts outreach in the US and Canada. And then we have Toby Snyder, has a background in cultural and media studies and is working on the Open Scholarship projects for more than 10 years. And in his current role as project manager at COPM, he looks after a variety of work packages that constitute COPM. So I'm going to hand over to Janine to start the videos, and then we'll get into the question and answer.
Great, thanks, Kim. Just bear with me whilst I get the video going, and please let me know if it doesn't work with regard to any technology. So first of all, we're going to hear from Martin Paul Eve. Just want to get this stuff on screen.
Hello, and thank you for having me here today. My name is Martin Paul Eve, and I'm Professor of Literature, Technology and Publishing at Birkbeck College at the University of London. And I'm going to start by giving an overview of the open access monograph landscape, new models that are emerging, and also a bit of background on the model that we've launched at the COPIM project, Opening the Future. My colleague Joe DeVille will then be talking about other aspects of the COPIM project and infrastructural gaps that we're hoping to fill. I wanted to back up a little bit and begin with a very basic statement about why open access and why does it matter. COVID-19 exposed how vital open access is for the future of scholarly communications, while at the same time it caused immense damage to library budgets and put us in a very difficult position to fund a transition. I am extremely clinically vulnerable, and during the pandemic I couldn't get to a library to access print copies. So the argument that people can just go to the library and this fixes the access gap in a very strong print ecology really doesn't hold much water anymore, given our experience of the past few years. We also know that traditional sales of academic books have dropped over the past 30 years, but we're still working as though we have a sustainable model for print sales of monographs. We know at the same time that open access offers increased readership, usage and citation, and we're also seeing a range of funder mandates coming through at this point. And I think that open access policies in the UK serve as a really good marker of what might be coming for the rest of the world, a sort of benchmark of where we're going. Our science minister, for instance, has stated that she wants us to go further with open access policies. And we just had a review conducted by UKRI, which is one of the major funders in the UK. And their policy is that from 1st of January 2024, there will be a mandate for open access monographs. There will also be a zero embargo green open access requirement included there if institutions do not pursue the gold route. There's a £3.6 million funding tag attached to that, which is going to be administered as and when people come forward with projects that have monographs attached. Next in our country is the review of REF, though, where we don't know what's happening at the moment with that. This is our national research funding exercise, a bit like ERA, I believe, in the Australasian context. But the ministerial steer is clear on the direction of travel, and it seems likely that the policies will be harmonised with one another. And if that's the case, almost all UK monographs would be subject to a funding mandate. But it's not quite clear how that would be funded in our country yet. So if you want to think about where we're going, this demonstration of OA policies from the UK hopefully serves as a bit of a weather vane for checking what's going to happen next. So it's amid this context that the COPIM project came into being, which is a £3.6 million international partnership funded by Research England Development Fund, and also the Arcadia Trust, which is a charitable fund of Lisbeth Rousing and Peter Baldwin. Thanks to their generous work, we're bringing together libraries, universities, OA book publishers, researchers and infrastructure providers to think about what's missing at the moment for the open access monograph landscape, and to think about how we can move that ahead. And that spans thinking about metadata provision all the way through to business models for university presses. And I'm going to talk a little bit now about the transition and business models that have been put in place and that are helping existing and new presses to find ways to sustain open access book publishing in a way that's fair and allows them to remunerate their staff and so forth. And the last year has been incredibly exciting for that, because we've seen really the emergence of three different strata of new funding schemes that try to avoid book processing charges. And I must stress that really book processing charges are incredibly damaging in the disciplines where monographs play a core role. Most humanities academics, for instance, have no chance of going to their executive dean and asking for £11,000 book processing charge. But membership models and collective action models that have emerged over the past year, a bit like Subscribe to Open in the journal space, really give us a much clearer route to how we might achieve OA monographs. So I first wanted to point out that these originated in the scholar-led scene, where small born open access presses run by academics were seeking out models for their own sustainability. Presses like Open Book Publishers, for instance, Trinity College Cambridge, and Punctum Books in the US instigated membership model schemes where libraries can pay to support their presses, and they make the books open access without book processing charges. There's also been a range of initiatives from large, relatively well-funded academic presses. MIT's Direct to Open scheme, for instance, is a subscription threshold model where if enough libraries subscribe to the front list, then the whole front list that year is made open access. Cambridge University Press have their Flip It Open scheme, where essentially if a title hits a sales threshold, so it sells enough copies, they make that book openly accessible. There's a range, though, of small to medium-sized academic presses, university presses, who need new models as well that are safe for them to try out and can lead to a transition. And that's where the Opening the Future model that we've piloted at COPIM comes into play. I'm just going to describe that as a case study here. So Opening the Future is a model where a library purchases subscription to backlist packages of non-OA books for their own catalogues. So at the presses we're working with, for instance, there are packages of 50 books. Libraries subscribe to those for their own collection only. It's not open access, and they get access to those titles. What the publisher then does, though, is it uses the revenue from those backlist subscriptions to make frontlist titles openly accessible once the revenue is in place on a book-by-book basis. And we're piloting this model with two presses, so Liverpool University Press at the series level and the Central European University Press, working to transition their entire research monograph front list to an openly accessible model without book processing charges. And we've tried to work on this on a sustainable front for libraries as well as for the presses. So our most expensive deal for these 50 books is $2,200 or so, whereas for the smallest institutions, you're talking just $670. It's unlimited DRM-free access to the package of titles, so it says no concurrency restrictions and so forth. And metadata is provided in MARC and KBART formats with counter-compliant statistics. I think what's quite exciting is that if we can get this to the level we need of support from libraries, the cost per book goes down dramatically. And that's the real benefit of these collection action models that are emerging, is that the more libraries participate, the less it costs per library per book. So you could just be talking about 17 Australian dollars per book, or 19 New Zealand dollars per book per institution, if we get to the target where we're producing 25 new open access books per year on this scheme. Also, these models can be melioristic and improve one book at a time rather than being an all or nothing scheme. So in the Opening the Future model, as libraries join, obviously the presses accrue a certain level of revenue. And once they hit the threshold for what would have been a book processing charge, it's just the next book that's going to be published that's made open access. So we gradually unlock that front list book by book, title by title, until we get to the whole press being open access. Academics just then come to the press, publish as they've always done, and the same quality control processes, but they're not confronted with book processing charges. And we've made open access happen without making academics panic about being able to afford a book processing charge and so forth. What we're trying to get away from as well, though, in models like this, and that I think are important for libraries to understand, is that this model is not a read and publish deal. We've seen some amazingly mega scale read and publish deals with the big commercial players. And I have some concern that this is going to start eating into the ability of smaller presses who really have disciplinary value from transitioning to open access, because, say, all of our funding has been spent on the big commercial players on getting a read and publish deal in place with them. So we're trying to decouple this you pay for your own researchers logic so that we can transition the entire landscape and so that we get there without causing friction for academics. So that's where I'm going to stop. If you want to know more, please do drop me an email. I'm martin.eve@bbk.ac.uk. You can also check out our websites at openingthefuture.net, copim.ac.uk and copim.pubpub.org. I hope that was a good bit of background for today. And now I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Joe, to talk more about infrastructure and so forth. Thank you very much.
So that's a great introduction from Martin, and really fascinating to see the model that's been produced. So I'm going to, what we're going to do now is we're going to have questions from the panel that's here, and then we'll go into the second video. So I'll just encourage everybody to type their questions into the chat. But whilst you're all thinking about that, I'm going to kick off, and I'm not sure who wants to take this. Actually, there we go. Livy, would you like to, you've got some links to share. Let me just ask a couple of questions first off. So I guess one of the things that I would really be curious about is that this is, you know, I think we're finding that there are quite a lot of complex new models for different models of open access. And this is a new one, which I hadn't seen before. How do we best advocate for this at an institutional level? And what is it that incentivizes institutions to support this? I'm not sure who'd like to take that as a question.
I should probably take this one, given that I've been working quite closely with Martin on the model. So I guess to kind of answer the second part of your question, I'd say it reasonably bluntly in a way that to incentivize you, we've been working on this for a good couple of years and talking about, you know, experimental models and pilots. And we're getting to a point where we're kind of feeling like we need these not to be talked about as pilots anymore, and not talked about as experiments, or simply they will fold up and fail, and we'll be left with just a BPC environment. So I guess one of the ways we'd hope to incentivize libraries to get on board is to find some funds if they can to support these pilots, and let's turn them from being an experiment into very much part of the landscape. And then to return to the first part of your question about the sort of models beginning to appear, I hesitate to use the word proliferate, because I think in the journal world, I feel it's got quite complicated. There are lots of models out there. I can't imagine working in a library trying to juggle transformative agreements with legacy stuff, legacy subscriptions and all the rest of it. It must be a bit of a nightmare. What we're seeing is some models emerging in the monograph world, but I don't think nearly as many as the journal space. I think it's simpler than perhaps people think it is. Martin's three strata slide, I think, is quite a useful one there to try and differentiate. It's really good to see different models, and despite having worked on this particular one for quite a long time, I don't think it's absolutely right for everyone as it happens. It's just another way of helping us to push the conversation forward, and to for those, maybe those small presses with a good backlist, it might work for them.
Great, thanks, Tom. I mean, I think one of the things it does highlight is the importance of diversity cannot be overestimated. We, as you say, we absolutely need a diverse ecosystem of open access approaches. So I'm just going to take some questions from the chat. So first from Kim, What comes first, libraries joining Opening the Future or academics coming to Copium with an idea for a book? What's the driver there?
So it's definitely the libraries coming forward. What we're trying to move away from is this concept of funding at a title level, and we're trying to decouple authors being attached to an institution and therefore get published. So what you might call a transformative agreement or a read and publish agreement. For us, any press can run with this model, I should say. By the way, we're releasing a toolkit on how to set it up. We've released the code already. If a press wanted to run with this, they could just switch it on any time in a sense, and it doesn't really matter about the authors, as long as the authors are in the pipeline are happy to be published OA. So what we're looking for is for libraries to look at the packages of books available and to subscribe, and then that goes into kind of a big pot to kind of fund a global collection rather than looking at a local collection approach.
And just briefly to add to that, Tom, if I may, it's important as well to emphasise that Copium itself is not a publisher. So Copium is an infrastructure project, and we're facilitating the work of publishers to publish OA in different ways, and this is one of those ways.
Thank you. That's really important. And again, I sort of just highlights as the complexity, but having this kind of described incredibly well is very helpful. So let me just go on to some more of the questions. So one from Mike saying, how would publishers maintain revenue under Opening the Future? Once libraries subscribe to the backlist titles in order to open up the front list, is that guaranteed to maintain funding for future open titles, especially if the backlist titles don't age well and dropped by libraries?
That's an excellent question, actually, Mike. And it's probably the most common question we get, and I understand why. It's sometimes framed as, you know, what happens when the backlist runs out? I'll try and answer this. So I'm going to try and channel my internal Professor Martin Eve, who usually says, certainly with Central European University Press, who were kind of the first ones to jump on board with this, they're a publisher of some standing over many years. They've got enough backlist, we estimate, to do this for 25 years. And Martin's reply is, if we're still talking about this in 25 years' time, then we've got a much bigger problem. So I don't wish to be flippant, but what I do mean to highlight is that there are publishers out there for whom this model works, who have the depth of backlist, and this can be a sustainable model until the environment changes. This is one way to push towards that environment change.
Yeah, that's a great answer. I really hope we're not here in 25 years still talking about this, but here we go. Okay, one question again about how this differs from the read and publish agreements. I think that would be really good to expand a bit more on if you could.
So I guess this is one for me again. So, I mean, I'm not an expert on how read and publish works, but as I understand it, it's this concept of if your researchers at your institution kind of want to publish with your own university press, for example, if you've got kind of a read and publish deal going, or not with your university press, but with a publisher that has a read and publish deal, then if you've got that deal going, then your authors can publish with them without having to pay BPCs. I haven't described that very well at all, but it's 2 o'clock in the morning. But hopefully those of you that don't know what read and publish is can find a better explanation than that. Anyway, it suffice to say that the Opening the Future, the model is not that at all. The next book that gets published as open access is just the next one in the pipeline. So an author can submit a book proposal to a participating publisher through the normal proposal editorial process. It will go through peer review. All the usual editorial standards will apply. And all it is that instead of being published in the sort of the traditional manner, if enough funding has accrued through Opening the Future membership to make it into an open access title, the closed version won't ever get published. It will just be flipped to an open version. So there is a bit of juggling required there on the publisher's part, because you know, you've got to prepare as if it's going to be a closed, gated title, because you don't know if you've got the money together just yet. And then you've got to make sure that people don't buy it. So there's a little bit of juggling to make sure that libraries don't sort of purchase it and then it goes to open access, if you see what I mean. But so far, the Central European University Press has published, I think, 5, and they've got 6 and 7 in the pipeline. They're getting pretty slick now about making sure that the metadata gets changed on Gobi, and so that libraries can see straight away that they don't need to purchase it because it's been earmarked. The funding has been accrued, and it's been earmarked for an open title. We've got a few more links on this that I'll drop into the chat that might explain it a bit better than my stumbling this time of the morning, but that's it in essence.
It might just be worth briefly adding as well, if it's okay. There's kind of an important point to make here as well, I think, about read and publish deals in general tend to reward larger publishers because, you know, if you're a larger publisher, then more authors from that institution are going to want to publish with that publisher. So it's more worthwhile having that kind of agreement. Whereas the sorts of models that COPIM's trying to build is to try and support small to medium sized publishers. So they may not have the kind of scale that could make a kind of read and publish deal attractive necessarily to a single institution, but the sort of models that we're devising can work for those smaller presses.
Great, thanks for that, Lucy. Could I ask a question of Livy about how you do outreach in the US and Canada? I wonder if what kinds of questions are coming up there with regard to COPIM and such like, and how you talk about those.
Well, we get many different questions, and I think because the main output that I'm working on is the OBC, which is actually what we're going to hear about next. But we have everything about, you know, funding models, content, local relevance. So I don't want to give too much away because we're actually going to dive into that next.
Okay, fair enough. All right, well, maybe unless there's anything that you want to talk about with regard to Martin's presentation, should we go on and do the next, let's do the next video, and then we'll come back for some more concerted questions after that. All right, so give me a moment and I will share my screen.
So hi, my name is Joe DeVille. I'm a lecturer at Lancaster University, but I'm also jointly leading one of the work packages in the COPIM project. And today I'm going to be talking to you about the main output of that work package, and perhaps the main output actually of the COPIM project as a whole, and that is the Open Book Collective, which is going to be a new organisation launching later this year. So what are the aims of the Open Book Collective? So the first aim is to generate new revenue streams for OA book publishers and service providers. Service providers are infrastructure and providers that provide those crucial infrastructural backbones of the OA book publishing landscape. And then also for publishers in particular to support a model of OA book publishing not reliant on book processing charges. We see book processing charges as problematic in all kinds of different ways. We also want to make it easier for librarians and other potential supporters to support OA membership schemes. I'll say a bit more about membership schemes in a second. And finally, we want to build a new community of publishers, of service providers, and of librarians. Too often we think these different components of the OA publishing ecosystem have worked largely in silos. A word also about the ethos of the Open Book Collective. Underpinned by an ethos of open infrastructure. So all our development components of the platforms that we build will be available on open licenses and archived in relevant repositories. The Open Book Collective is a not-for-profit, is in the very final processes of registering as a charity in the UK. Also have a governance structure that means we can't be bought up by large commercial entities, as has happened in the past in relation to service providers within the OA publishing space. The Open Book Collective will be community led. Those involved in open access publishing and service revision and libraries will all have opportunities to become involved in the governance of the Open Book Collective. And we're really committed to supporting bibliodiversity. supporting a wide range of different publishers, but also a wide range of publishing models, different languages, different subject areas, different kinds of books. Now, I mentioned membership models. I want to talk a little bit more about that. Some of you may well be quite familiar with this, but some of you may not. Here are four examples of membership models, as offered by Punctum Books on the left, then Open Book Publishers, second left, then Opening the Future that Martin's talked about, and the OAPEN Library Membership Programme. These are all library membership programmes where different organisations, whether publisher or service provider, goes to a library and asks them for forms of financial support. Now, for publishers, that doesn't necessarily mean funding content. Their content is already open. But what the publisher is doing, and also what the service provider or the infrastructure provider is doing, is saying, look at what I've produced in the past. I've shown that I have a track record of producing high quality content or a high quality infrastructure, and therefore it would greatly support the open access publishing ecosystem if you were to support me on an ongoing basis for a contracted period. That is the library membership program model. The challenge is that we have a number of these different library membership programs working in isolation. It can be really hard then for the librarian to assess them against one another, to compare them against one another. And also there's a lot of labor involved with assessing lots of individual initiatives and dealing with all the individual people who are responsible for those initiatives. So one of the key things that the Open Book Collective will do It will hope to make this process easier, and it will do that by building a new platform that allows librarians to begin to understand different library membership programs and to be able to compare them against one another. So I'm just going to take you straight into the heart of this new platform that we're in the very final stages of developing. As you can see, on the platform there will be individual library membership programs on offer to those that want to support them. That's what's shown on the right of the screen there as you sort of scroll down the page. So we have Punctum Books' library membership program top right there. We have other library membership programs on offer. These are all indicative, I should say, but we expect the ones shown on this screen to be available at launch alongside a number of others. And or the librarian can support collections of library membership programs. So, for example, the scholar-led collection, which represents actually all the publishers there shown on the right. Or indeed supporting everything on the platform. They can support the Open Book Collective as a whole. So it provides a way of a librarian going into the platform and beginning to understand more about these individual initiatives. Of course, they can click on them, find out more about them, find out more about what they're doing, the subject areas they're working in, the values, the governance structures, and so on. So I want to say a little bit about the potential benefits for librarians and institutions of this new platform. This, by the way, I should say, is the homepage of the site. So here we go. Aggregation. The platform acts as a membership package aggregator and discovery portal. That's perhaps one way of thinking about it. It helps provide information about the relevance of different initiatives to a particular institution. The platform is designed to provide quick and consistent information about the values, the priorities, the subject focuses of different initiatives, including actually, there's also a full book catalogue, which I'll talk about more in a second. The Open Book Collective also conducts rigorous forms of due diligence on all the initiatives that are available to support on the platform. An expert panel who, when someone applies to be to offer their membership package on the platform, will scrutinise them, will scrutinise their peer review procedures, their governance procedures, their business models, and so on. The platform should also help simplify the workflow involved in supporting a library membership programme. The existence of the Open Book Collective will mean one potentially procurement process rather than putting a range of different initiatives through the procurement process. That means that a library or other supporter can support a range of different initiatives through this one provider, through the Open Book Collective. But we also know that many libraries want to support publishers or membership programs via existing third-party payment arrangements. So, for example, here in the UK, JISC, or in the US, Lyrisys. And we expect to be able to make it possible to support the Open Book Collective through those kinds of third-party payment providers. The platform will also provide consolidated contracts. So rather than lots of different contracts with lots of different initiatives, a single contract with then appendices for all the different membership packages that are supported. For publishers and service providers, here are some of the benefits from their perspective. One, similar to libraries, but in a quite different way, workflow. So for them, it's managing the process of invoicing, of contracting, of dealing with payment and payment flows. And all this means that what the Open Book Collective does, it makes it possible for even the smallest publisher to offer a library membership program. The OBC also undertakes outreach on behalf of publishers to a potential global community of supporters. It allows them, publishers, to reduce their BPCs or hopefully transition away from BPCs entirely, and also provides new revenue streams for service providers, helping make OA infrastructures far more sustainable. A word on who the Open Book Collective is aimed at. So we can see that there are three broad strata of non-BPC based open access publishing models in the OA book publishing ecosystem. Large, well-funded academic presses, small to medium-sized academic presses, and scholar-led born OA presses. The OBC Open Book Collective is primarily aimed at the second and third of those categories, as well as at service providers for OA books. Here is the quotation page that the library user will get to once they've selected some membership packages for potential support. And just a few words on how the kind of financial process will work. OA running costs are shared between publishers and service providers on the one hand and libraries on the other hand. There will be opportunities for everyone involved in the platform to become involved in governance. Publishers and service providers also contribute to a separate fund, which is available for publishers, service providers, whether involved in the OBC or not, to potentially apply for to build capacity in various areas. All financial information, including our fees and our revenue, will be reported openly and transparently. Okay, so that's the platform. I just wanted to say a few words about one particular feature of the platform that may be of interest, and that is the collective catalogue that I mentioned earlier. If publishers use a particular back-end solution, the Tote back-end solution, which I'll talk more about in a second, they will be represented in this collective catalogue that then, of course, you can filter by publisher, filter by subject area, and so on. You'll also be able to download metadata very easily in relation to particular books, as is shown here. And that is all made possible because in the back-end, we have this, this infrastructural solution, the Tote Open Metadata System. This is another output of the Copin project, and one we're very proud of, I should say. And what it means is that it allows publishers to input information about their books into a central location and then to export that metadata to a range of different platforms, making it incredibly much more easy for them to manage the process of dealing with metadata. And we hope this will significantly improve the quality of metadata that is available about open access books. Okay, that's enough from me. And we're launching later this year. Here are two ways in which you can follow our work. Thanks very much.
Great. Well, that was a fascinating kind of explanation of this collective approach that's happening. And I think it's a really interesting, to see that this is coming together. So, whilst I wait for some questions to come in, Livy, do you want to talk about how you've been advocating for this in the US and what are the kinds of questions you're getting in relation to the advocacy?
Right. So I want to say to also address some of the last questions that it's challenging just in the US to respond to, you know, US libraries because there are so many different librarians and institutions. So approaching this on a global level is very difficult. But one question we get asked a lot is just how do we join? How does it work? How can we evaluate initiatives? So I'm actually going to put one more thing in the chat. just about kind of breaking down our criteria and also some really important points that we have learned from many of our library workshops. So I'm just going to enter that really quick.
Just to say to everybody, we will capture everything that's in the chat and make sure that we add it to the page about these webinars afterwards. So don't worry that you're going to lose it if you don't get a chance to look at it just now. Vivi, whilst you're doing that, I'm going to just prep a question about the metadata. I'm really curious to hear more about that and how important that's going to be. So do you want to go to that, or Vivi, do you want to go back to you?
Yes, I actually realized that my response that I wanted to enter in the chat is actually very long, so I'm going to kind of break it up. Okay, so let's see, Open Book Collection. What's the difference between this and platforms like Pressbooks or OER Commons? Lucy or Toby, do you actually have a better answer for that?
So I think the main difference that I'd say is that the OBC isn't necessarily about helping publishers to create books in the sense of it doesn't provide any kind of tools to help them editorially or in terms of the production. But what the OBC is intended to do primarily is to kind of help with financial flows. So for example, a press like Open Book Publishers has a library membership program, and that means that library supporters, not because the money is attached to a particular book project or a particular author or anything like that, they give us money because they want us to keep doing what we're doing, which is publishing open access books without charging authors book processing charges. And that revenue is about a third of our income at present at OBP, and we're hoping to grow that. So what the Open Book Collective is trying to do is trying to make that possible for more presses, so that smaller presses can devise this kind of program and that the OBC can implement it for them. Because at OBP, you know, with publishers, it certainly takes, you know, a staff member a good chunk of time to be working on this program. And from the library side, it makes, as Joe was explaining, you know, it makes it easier for librarians, because they'll be able to assess a number of these presses and initiatives all in one place, have a bespoke package which they want to support, and to be able to do that sort of quite simply through kind of one transaction. So, you know, in those ways, it's really quite different from things like Pressbooks, I think. Yeah, it's targeted at academic presses, that's right.
Yeah. So just following on from that question, I guess what we're seeing increasingly is that the barriers, the reason why people, you know, organizations are not supporting openness at the moment is just because it's really hard for them to do it. And what you're aiming to do with this in particular is to make it easy for them to transfer their money, as it were, to openness rather than to subscriptions. Is that correct? Is that the biggest barrier, do you think, or are there other barriers that you have to overcome?
I think there's feedback that we've been getting from libraries is that one of the things that libraries care about is local relevance. And I think a platform like the OBC is going to help them with that, because, you know, all of the different presses and all the collections, open collections, will be available to view on this platform. So as a library, you can kind of, you know, pick and choose and decide, well, what's the most attractive package for my institution to help me make the best case for some funding here. I think, you know, that's kind of one thing. There are libraries as well in institutions that are thinking, particularly with, in the UK, the introduction of policies like UKRI, open access books are things that we need to be supporting, and we're not massively keen on the book processing charge model. Here's another initiative that's trying something different, and so we're interested to find out more about it. But I think I find that different institutions have different arguments that they need to make, and I'm sure everybody here is aware of that. So the Open Book Collective can kind of give you a couple of different ways in, I suppose, to try and make those arguments that, you know, open access books need supporting, and that this is a good way to support them.
Great. And do you have a sense that, you know, of course, the trick is that once you get people to support this one year, getting them to support it in following years is, you know, kind of gets incrementally easier. But do you have any sense for how that might work? I know that you're at the very beginning of the Open Book Collective, but what about for COPIM and such like? Do you think that once people are in, they're in for good?
Well, I think that's certainly a hope. I mean, I can only speak from what we've been doing at OBP with our library membership programme, but libraries are very loyal to that. You know, and even this year, for the first time, we've been adjusting the prices slightly. It's for the last sort of 5 or 6 years, it's been the same price. And this year we're experimenting with a tiered system. And we're giving libraries an out in a sense, because we're saying, you know, if you don't want to join at the tier that we've suggested or move up to the tier that we've suggested, you can remain on your current tier. And most of them are not only staying with the membership program, but they are moving up as we're asking them to do. So I think, you know, once you, as you said, once you get libraries in and once you give them a reason to keep supporting you, we've certainly found with what we've been doing so far that libraries have sort of stuck with it. You know, obviously it's kind of a new thing, and it remains to be seen how the funding is always all going to shake out. But we hope that at least, as you say, you know, once we're in the door, then we've won the initial argument at least.
And I have to say that I think librarians really respond to the fact that they are integrated into the governance. I mean, we have done researching, so much research listening to them. So we're making this to serve them. So we definitely place value on their voice. So I don't think they would, I mean, they have room for it. So I don't see them, I mean, yeah, like Lucy said, I hope that they would stay because they feel they have power in this organization.
If I could add to that, a kind of a real world experience as well, which is so Martin Eve launched the Open Library of the Humanities several years ago, which some of you may be familiar with, and his experience there, which is a, sort of another attempt at unlocking open access, but for journals, his experience was that libraries will sign up initially, even just for 1 year, just to get it as a line item on their budgets onto their Excel spreadsheets. And then it's much harder to take it off the spreadsheet the next year. Obviously, you know, things change and there are always financial squeezes. But by and large, his experience has been that once it's on, it's much easier to stay on than to get it on in the first place.
And also, if I may just add to like the more ethical perspective towards that, I think, as Livy and Lucy and Thomas have mentioned, there is this, of course, this benefit of getting it in the books and all that, and getting accustomed to this new situation. But I think what the Open Book Collective also wants to add, as like what you hear in the larger discourse, this kind of added benefit is really the ethical implications that the Open Book Collective tries to find an alternative solution to, compared to the established routes that are out there. And this really being the ethical benefit of making things work together with scholars, working together with scholar-led presses, with infrastructure providers that are not-for-profit organizations. And yeah, like this whole community that we really want to form within the Open Book Collective, that wants to build like an alternative ecosystem, really, that supports open access books publishing from this ethical perspective, really. Yeah.
And I have to say, working with Punctum and doing outreach, many of the libraries who sign on are signing on because of their values, because their ethical values are aligned with Punctum. Sure, some of it may be because there's a need to fill a line item, but most of the time we do receive a lot of feedback, and it is because of the ethical values. I just hope that you know, we can do more of that.
I think the other thing that it also, I mean, what just strikes me that you're doing is you're kind of making visible the kind of universe, as it were, of open book options, in the same way that I think that, you know, so for example, Coalitionist did when it did its Diamond Open Access Journal study. Suddenly, you know, we all knew about Diamond Open Access Journals individually, but now it became apparent that there's a vast, as they call it, archipelago of these out there. And that, you know, yours brings it together in the same way that theirs does. So I think that's really important. Can I ask a technical question, which I'm really curious about the metadata project and how that is, kind of feeds into the importance, and perhaps somebody could talk to why that's so important and why libraries should be caring about the fact that there is good quality metadata around these projects.
So I think we're all slightly nervous of talking about TOTE because none of us work directly on it. But so if anyone wants to jump in from COPIM and add to what I'm going to say, But I think, yeah, I think there's obviously there's a, you know, problem with metadata, particularly for open access books. I think that publishers are creating good quality metadata, and then it goes through, you know, third party aggregators or suppliers, and it gets dismantled and put back together again in ways which are less useful and less complete. So Tote is attempting to offer an open metadata system. So publishers are going to be able to use it to upload their metadata. Libraries are going to be able to use it to download that metadata in whatever format they wish. And it's also, I think, going to be editable to an extent as well because it's open. So it's we want it to become a kind of trove of high quality metadata for OA books. And it's also going to underlie the Open Book Collective catalogue, which Libby might be able to say a bit more about. But essentially, I think it's going to help presses to display their books on the Open Book Catalogue, Open Book Collective, sorry, platform, because they're part of Tote. And, you know, Tote's, it's got more capacity than that as well. For example, at Open Book Publishers, we're on Tote, we use it for all of our metadata management, and it's also underlying our website. We're about to shift to a new website, and that sort of, you know, all of our book catalogue, all the book metadata, the book's presence on that website will be underpinned by Tote. So there's lots of different things that it can do. You know, we hope that it will be a useful tool for libraries as well that want this kind of good quality OA metadata in their catalogues.
Yeah, and I have to say that in speaking with librarians, there isn't just this general view on metadata. Rather, some librarians have mentioned that, oh, I just want this off my plate. I want someone else to do this. This is important, but, you know, I'm so overloaded that, you know, this would be just a great help. And so we're trying to provide that. But others have been really particular. They are very particular about what kind of metadata is, you know, they're wanting to change. And so I think Tote is really flexible for both types of librarians. But also I'm going to cut it short because I noticed that we actually just had another question. So I'm going to read that and allow it.
Great, thanks. All right, so let's just go to this last one, and then what I'll ask, perhaps if you want to all do one final kind of wrap up. So just, this is from Kim. So how can libraries in Australasia and Open Access Australasia, our group, how can we support the work that you've presented today, Copence and Book Collective?
Well, I think, you know, sharing what we're doing more widely is something that we're really keen to do. So, you know, making sure that your institutions are aware of the sorts of things that Copen's building, and also, you know, that researchers and authors are aware that there are efforts going on to develop BPC-free ways to publish open access, and that this, it's not necessarily going to have to be a kind of expensive add-on that you might do, but it's actually a way you can just publish as part, you know, almost as part of your normal way of working and way of publishing. I think that would be a key way. I think, obviously, if any libraries in the audience want to sign up to any of these programs, I'm sure, you know, we'd obviously be delighted about that as well. But I think, you know, raising sort of the awareness of what we're trying to do and the sort of values that underlie what we're trying to do would be great as far as we're concerned. I don't know if anyone wants to add to that.
Absolutely. Thank you, Lucy. Yeah, I'd probably be less subtle, and I would just say sign up. You know, go to openingthefuture.net. Check out the backlist packages. We've got two presses on board. If any of the backlist packages look like they would enhance your local collection, it's pretty cheap. Sign up. Yep, there you go. I'll say it quite bluntly.
Thanks very much. Well, I think we might, unless there's anything you'd like to finally end with, we might finish almost at that point because it's just before the hour. Tom, Livy, Toby, Lucy, anything last you'd like to say that you might want to, we haven't covered in the questions already?
Only thank you for having us and for giving us this opportunity.
Great. Well, it was really you're very welcome. It was incredibly fascinating. Kim, I'll leave, pass over to you for final words.
I'd just like to say, Ngā mihi nui ki a koutou katoa. Thank you very much for your time and sharing your knowledge and the exciting developments at Copen with the OAA communities of practice in Australasia. It's great to have this conversation. And Michelle Blake, unfortunately, who was the person behind getting this happening is unwell. So, but she'll be so excited that it actually went ahead. And it was a very vibrant and interesting conversation. So I'll give her your best wishes. And again, thank you very much for your time. Ka kite anō, hopefully we'll see you again.
That would be great, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, everyone.
Ka kite.
Thank you.
Thank you.